Okay, so I figured we'd check out Unpacked again. We just did the Sephardic and Ashkenazi differences. We did Mizrahi yesterday, and now we're on to the Ethiopian Jews. So this one's 2 years old, so hopefully a lot of the information is still relevant. But yeah, let's just jump into it.
Ethnic minorities in Israel, a case study. Hey!
Hi. Hello.
When you think of a Jewish Israeli, what if...
Okay, interesting. So this is a lot different than the other two videos that we saw.
image comes to mind?
I don't know, maybe this or this or this.
Okay. Well, for me, there's a particular Israeli story that speaks to me. This. The story of Ethiopian Jewry. It's epic.
I keep hearing this word Jewry. I didn't realize that that's what it was, how it was referred to. Ethiopian Jewry, Mizrahi Jewry, Sephardic Jewry.
They've overcome adversity and challenges both in Ethiopia and in Israel, and help make Israel the multifaceted, complex society that it is.
Very nice, but who are they? I've heard the terms Falashas and Beta Israel, but which is which? Or are those the same thing?
Ah, yes, Beta Israel. Somebody did in the comment section say that Beta Israel was referring to Ethiopian Jews. Okay.
Ethiopian Jews traditionally refer to themselves as Beta Israel. However, some of Beta Israel were pressured to convert to Christianity in the 19th and 20th centuries, and they became known as Falash Mura, or Falashas, a derogatory designation in Amharic, meaning strangers or migrants. They were given this...
Okay, so Falashara means stranger or migrant, got you, because they converted to Christianity, okay.
Pejorative name because Beta Israel no longer consider them to be authentic Jews. But it's important to note that Christian and Muslim Ethiopians refer to all Ethiopian Jews, including Beta Israel, as Falashas, because to the non-Jews, they were all strangers.
Yeah, that's not confusing at all. So,
okay, maybe she's going to get into, clearing up the confusion here. Wait.
Who are they? Where do they come from? And how did they end up in Ethiopia? Well, there are...
Okay, so... I'm gonna go back just to play that one part again that she was talking about. Sorry.
Muslim Ethiopians refer to all Ethiopian Jews, including Beta Israel, as Falashas, because to the non-Jews, they were all strangers.
To the non-Jews, they were all strangers. Okay, gotcha. Okay.
Yeah, that's not confusing at all. So who are they? Where do they come from? And how did they end up in Ethiopia?
Well, there are approximately 144,000 Ethiopian Jews living in Israel today, 1.6% of the population.
I was going to say that doesn't sound like a very large number. I would assume the rest of them are within Ethiopia?
And their origins are from their tradition trace their roots all the way back to the tribe of Dan, one of the original 12 tribes of Israel.
Is that the one that got lost?
Well, them and 9 others, but that's just one tradition.
So Israel had 12 tribes and 9 of them went missing, or 10 of them went missing? Because she said, are those one of the 12? Yeah, one of them. Yeah.
Other traditions tie them to King Menelik, the son of King Solomon and the Queen of Sheba, one of his 700 wives.
Holy sh**, that's a lot of wives.
These Ethiopian Jews had been disconnected from the rest of Jewish society for over 2,000 years. That's before the creation of the Mishnah, Talmud, gefilte fish, you know, like some of the basics of Judaism today.
So they're saying that these Jews didn't even know about the other Jews because they were so segmented and separated from the other Jews, and they didn't realize, and they were already established as a Jew, as a Jewish culture 2,000 years prior to all those other things.
They practice a form of biblical Judaism, which has a lot of differences, but also many similarities with the Jewish practices we're familiar with today.
So, like, they keep kosher, have Shabbat, holidays?
Yes and no. Before coming to modern Israel, they kept a form of kosher and the Sabbath, and kept the biblical holidays like Rosh Hashanah, Passover, and Sukkot. However, they did not celebrate holidays like Hanukkah, which commemorate historical events that occurred long after their community became fragmented from the rest of the Jewish world.
Well, that would make sense if, you know, the story of Hanukkah with the Maccabees and all that happened far later on than when they knew, you know.
Any Jewish laws or traditions that developed after the destruction of the first temple were unknown to them. Not only was it unknown to them, but up until the 19th century, most of them hadn't heard of Jews outside of Ethiopia at all. They thought that they were the last remaining Jews in the world.
They must have been pretty surprised to find out there were white Jews too.
Yeah.
So how did they end up back in Israel?
Well, the Ethiopian Jews...
Sorry, this girl's a little, you know, the acting's all right, I guess.
Jews had dreamed of returning to Zion for thousands of years, but in the 1970s and early 80s, Ethiopia found itself embroiled in civil war and famine, which led to the deaths of thousands and an increase in the persecution the Ethiopian Jews already faced. So thousands of Ethiopian Jews began the long journey north by foot through desert and hostile territory, hoping to arrive in Israel. Northwest, actually. Once they reached...
Okay, so Ethiopia, Sudan. Okay.
Sudan, they couldn't travel any further and remained languishing in refugee camps. It is estimated that as many as 4,000 died from starvation and disease during the nearly 750-mile trek through the desert and during the years spent in the refugee camps. But then,
let me guess, Israel came to the rescue.
Good guess! Israel fulfilled the ancient prophecy and flew them to the Holy Land on the wings of eagles. It wasn't that simple. In the years leading up to this, Israel had sent Mossad agents to smuggle smaller numbers of Ethiopian Jews to Israel, but it actually took a...
So my question then is, how did the Israeli Jews know about the Ethiopian Jews if the Ethiopian Jews had no idea who the Israeli Jews were? Like, if the Ethiopian Jews thought that they were the last Jewry that there was, how did the Israeli Jews know about them to go and get them and bring them to Israel?
A lot of pressure from Jewish advocacy groups to get the government to begin a large-scale program.
So it took a lot of nudging to get the Israeli bureaucracy to get moving? That sounds about right.
Well, there was the need to keep the rescue on the down low and on a small scale to prevent the Sudanese and Ethiopian governments from cracking down and preventing immigration.
Sudanese? Is that what she said?
To prevent the Sudanese and Ethiopian governments from cracking...
Sudanese, I don't know what that is. Yeah. But the Ethiopian government, they would have a problem with them leaving?
Down and preventing immigration, so that slowed things down too.
That sort of sounds like a cop-out.
It's a sticky subject. Also, you have to remember that Israel was a very small country, and the government felt that it needed to determine how to successfully integrate the Ethiopian Jews into Israeli society before bringing them in mass. Makes sense, right? But part of the Israeli government's hesitancy was that many weren't convinced that the Ethiopian Jews were truly Jewish due to the uncertainty of their origins.
Ah, and if they're not Jewish, they're not eligible to immigrate under the law of return.
Correct.
The law of return. I think maybe they'll get into it now, but I have never heard of the law of return.
The law of return, enacted in 1950, gives every Jew the right to live in Israel and gain citizenship. It subscribes to the notion of Israel as a safe haven from the persecution Jews had suffered for 2,000 years. That's not to say that non-Jews can't gain citizenship through naturalization. It's just not an automatic right. But in 1973, when the chief rabbi of Israel ruled that according to Jewish law, the Ethiopian Jews are in fact Jewish, the government's policies began to slowly shift.
So why did it take over like 20 some odd years, like 23 years it sounded like, for them to then realize or like recognize? If they already knew about the Ethiopian Jews and they were also already trying to incorporate them into the Israeli, like bring them to Israel and stuff and incorporate them within the society, why would it take so long for them to like be finally recognized and then awarded this?
So it took another 10 years for Israel to take action and rescue them on a larger scale? Finally, in 1984, Operation Moses was born. Over the course of 7 weeks, Israel secretly airlifted 8,000 Ethiopian Jews from the Sudan to Israel. But when the secret became public, Sudan, facing pressure from its Arab allies, cut off the operation. Thousands of Ethiopian Jews remained in war-torn Ethiopia, waiting for the day that they would join their brothers and sisters in Israel.
I mean, this sounds like a very small group, though. If they're saying within 7 weeks they were trying to bring over 8,000, but in total there was about 140,000, I think they said at the beginning of this. So what happened to the rest of them? Did they just stay in Ethiopia where they already were?
7 years later, Israel launched a daring mission, which they named Operation Solomon. In a period of less than 36 hours, Israel covertly airlifted 14,000 Ethiopian Jews to Israel.
What's up with this girl in the middle's attitude here? Like...
14,325. When all was said and done, Israel's Ethiopian population went from a few hundred in 1983 to over 20,000 in 1991. It bears mentioning that the process of integration for black Jews in Israel was quite different from that of African Americans in the American colonies.
I mean, that's still, I would say, not even a large number. Because if they were saying 1.6% of the Ethiopian Jews made up the Jewry, I guess, and you're only taking 20,000 of that, that's even a smaller portion.
Colonies. Yeah, in Israel, there was no slavery, no Jim Crow, no legalized systemic racism. The Ethiopian Jews came here to join their Jewish brothers and sisters as equal members of society. That was the dream. And as Herzl said, if you will it, it is no dream.
I knew we couldn't get through this without you quoting Herzl.
In America, our ancestors were brought as slaves and were later segregated. In Israel, Ethiopians were brought to freedom, and the goal was to integrate them.
So what, is Israel free of racism?
No, there is certainly some racism in Israel. Racism is a global problem, and Israel isn't spared from it, but—
Yeah, I mean— That's common knowledge. Wherever you go, there's going to be racism, whether it's rampant or undertoned or whatever. I mean, even just in these last few videos we've seen with the Sephardic and the Mizrahi and all that stuff, this Mizrahi, it's all, even some of the comments have been saying, like, you know, it was challenging for their parents growing up, even their grandparents growing up. For them now, it's a little bit easier. So for sure, yeah.
Overall, the integration of the Ethiopian Jews into Israeli society was a big success. Israelis welcomed the Ethiopians with open arms and were really moved by their aliyah, because all the differences they had didn't matter. What mattered is that they were Jews and part of one big family. Still, many complain of lack of opportunity, poverty, and police harassment.
Yeah, I've seen news clips of protests about this.
To prepare for the absorption of tens of thousands of Ethiopian Jews, the Israeli government developed an elaborate program covering issues of housing, education, and employment, but its approach did not sufficiently take into account social and cultural differences between the existing and incoming Ethiopian population.
So the existing, I guess, were those ones that were there already prior to them rushing all these new ones in. Or maybe they're talking about the ones back in Ethiopia?
Unlike European immigrants, Ethiopians were coming from remote rural villages and were not prepared to work and live in a modern industrialized society.
That makes sense.
This, despite Israel's efforts at bridging the socioeconomic gap, resulted in a strong social marginalization. But since then, they have come very far. Ethiopians are in the highest levels of government and industries. The gap is shrinking.
I still don't get why she's got to be acting like she's got so much attitude up there in the top corner. As if she's not happy to hear any of this. I mean, again, I would say it's not perfect, for sure. But a step towards progress is still a step towards progress, right?
Among young Ethiopians who were raised here, the gap in education and employment is almost closed. Agreed. Israel is a complex society and has its challenges, but there's also a lot of acceptance and respect for various cultures. It's rough, shifting terrain that Israel will always struggle to navigate, but it's important for Israel to set its eyes on the final destination, the Jewish values of equality and acceptance of others. And one of the best examples of this challenge is the story of the Ethiopian Jews.
100% agree with that last sentiment that you just said there. And that's kind of what I had said in one of the comments earlier tonight, was I kind of like to look at everybody as we're all just human beings first, and like not so much focus on like race, religion, all that stuff. Because yes, as much as that is important, and as much as that does make us different, obviously I'm not saying I don't see color. I know when somebody's black, when somebody's Asian, somebody's, you know, other than white or European or whatever the case may be, but I still see them as a human. And that's my main focus, is I just want to treat them with the utmost respect regardless. So if that is Israel's goal, is to just welcome all their different brothers and sisters, regardless if they're Ethiopian or Sephardic or, you know, Arabic, Mizrahi, all that stuff, then that's beautiful. That's the main goal, I think, that everyone should strive for. But yeah. Anyways, you guys let me know in the comment section below what you guys thought about this. If there's anything like important that she missed. I know a lot of these videos have been pretty like short and sweet, pretty fast, so they kind of skim over everything, but you guys have a little bit more information, feel free to let me know. And as always, like, comment, subscribe, and I'll catch you on the next one.